10 past, and now we'll call this meeting to order. Revised agenda for Board of Water Commissioners, special meeting to discuss a lot of budget items, and...
Good day, March 23rd.
March 23rd, thank you. So, call the meeting to order. Mary Beth, you ready?
I am, but I just noticed a mistake on Form 1. I'm gonna fix it.
Well, you do that, and we will look at the minutes. We'll skip down to approval of minutes. We'll do that while you're doing that. How's that sound?
Works for me.
Okey-dokey.
Why do we go up?
Is having no revision up there?
Excuse me?
Is that how you revised it? I've never seen the official budget. Are those revised figures?
Yes, we're gonna go through that.
Oh, okay.
Mr. Ralph, you're welcome to move up closer if it helps. We're trying to make it not an eye chart.
I
correction under new business. Number five, it says Chairman Manning said that Deb Fagan should be Egan.
I'm sorry, say that again?
New business, number five. And the first sentence after the bold, it says, Chairman Manning said that Deb Fagan should be Egan.
Oh, I'm sorry.
You spelled her last name, that's all.
Didn't you know how your eyes just look at it and you read it right?
Yeah, I did. I looked at it and I'm like, who's that? And I'm thinking, then I'm like, idiot, that's Deb Egan. Yeah.
Okay, sorry.
No, that's okay. That's just, yeah. Anybody else have any questions or issues?
Nope.
Make a motion to accept it as corrected.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Super.
Good job, Kathy.
All right. So, all set? Okay. So the first item is discuss the FY18 water budget concerns raised by the Board of Selectmen and the Finance Committee. Before we get into it, I just want to say that Brandon, you went with the Selectmen and Mary Beth and kind of went through things there. Mary Beth and I went with the FinCom. Is that this week? Yeah. Sorry. This week. And, you know, we got similar feedback. And again, and Jamie, not to pick on you, but you're here. With regards to the Finance Committee, I'm not sure how to go back, but twice I heard Peter and Roy?
Dennis Roy.
Make a statement that you guys are going to have a million in surplus. I just want to know, you know, I didn't really have everything there I could ask it, but how are they coming up with that number?
I don't know the answer.
Oh, I know you don't. That's why I'm saying, how do I go back?
Question.
What's the right way to go back and ask for clarification?
The certified free cash is right there.
Right.
It's that.
I believe, and this is just my supposition.
Yeah, no, it's okay.
Is the form that Dennis gave out would indicate a certain amount of surplus if the budget goes the way that it's supposed to, based on the 1.9% that he had put in,
okay,
combined with this, combined with what you already have. I believe that's how they got to $1 million, but I don't know that to be so. I will ask him.
I know, and that's why I'm just asking if you can,
absolutely,
if you could just ask him to just show me, because
I
didn't want to challenge, but I just want to know.
Absolutely.
And that makes it easier to have a clear discussion in this board. And we have a meeting next Tuesday, which was a meeting from the 14th, deferred because of the snow. And if he could either shoot an email to me or Mary Beth or the board, whoever.
Okay. We have a finance committee anyway, so obviously I can't contact Dennis directly, but I will send it through Larry and ask Larry to pass it on and get the answer to that.
Yeah, and I mean, with all respect, I just want to
understand
it instead of just going, oh, okay. That's all.
Did you just want me to email Dennis? Would it be easier if I just sent him an email tomorrow asking for clarification on that? Or? It's up to you
what
you want to handle.
Let's have Jamie take it.
Okay.
We could keep you focused on getting this stuff done.
Okay. I did make copies of that handout that Dennis had. We got one between the two of us.
Yeah.
So there is a copy of that. It should be in the, to make it easier, there's three sections to the packet, so it would be in the first section. I believe I put that little spreadsheet that Dennis had, yes, it's right in the first part underneath the budget.
This one?
It's that one that Dennis had somewhere in there in the first packet. Looks like this.
Yes.
That's it. Yep.
After this, it's standalone from the first packet. Okay.
So I'm still up here. Okay, found it.
All right. So, do you have the list of the questions, the budget questions? Do we want to walk through?
So, the most important thing, it's all important, but I do need, I revise the budget.
Yep.
To take into consideration the selectmen and the finance committee's condition to cut the budget by $100,000 in the maintenance line. So I thought we could start off, because we have to pass this tonight.
Yeah.
Okay, so I thought if we could go through, I've got it up on the screen,
yeah,
and I've got it color-coded, and I'll walk through to show you what I actually changed from the budget that the board had approved on February 7th.
Mm-hmm.
So, because it does address one of the concerns or issues that had come up, so mm-hmm. I could do that if you'd like.
Sure, we'll take it from there.
Okay. This first page is what goes to town meeting. So throughout the document, anything that I've highlighted yellow is what is different from what the board saw. Everything else is the same, but it's different from what the board saw on February 7th. So we went in and put the numbers in. Those weren't in there before. Each of the lines gets a number. And one of the, you know, the big things is one of the concerns what Dennis was talking about, there used to be more line items on the front, the first page that goes to town meeting. So as you see, we have engineering, and it's in customer service. That's the customer service. That's the Penachuk contract. Those were on, had their own line item before. So because those categories were already on that page, it was easy for me to pull those numbers out of the maintenance line. So when we get to that page, you'll see how I did that, and it's going to show up on this page under its own separate. So it was the first thing I did with the budget. Form two. This is the wages and salary line, and one of the suggestions from the Finance Committee, I think it was Dennis Roy, was to add the step.
Hold on, let's make sure we're on the same document here.
I've moved. All right, I was on Form One. We're going to keep probably flip back and forth.
I want to be able to get. So that's, I've got that document here.
Yep.
Yep. What's the next document?
Next document is Form Two. It's the salaries. The budget was in order. The budget when you in your packet was in order, in which we're going in right now. This is the one that has the salaries, the water department wages. It should have been page two behind that.
That doesn't look like what's up there.
Yeah, it's cut off.
Oh, I did it again. It's got the... Sorry, I did it again. I didn't highlight the whole spreadsheet.
It hasn't got anything to do with what position it is. It's just, if you look, go over two sections and that's where it starts. It steps.
Right, that was my mistake. I didn't highlight the whole spreadsheet when I printed it out. I cut off the position... That first column.
Next year, when we do the budget process, because one of the issues that has come up and I think caused some consternation is the some of the documentation and human error. So I think what we want to do is put a QAQC step in after we approve the budget. You produce the packet that's going to go to FinCom and what you call it. That you either have Kathy do it or have one of us, at a meeting. Just go through and make sure that the packet that's going out works. That's all.
Sure.
It's just standard QAQC stuff. That's all.
Sure.
Let's save a lot of grumbling from folks.
So the change that were made to this form was a suggestion was to add in the step of the incumbent in the position and to put the other thing was is I just one of the ones I had I added the word vacant next to janitor. And then I just, to be consistent with the other positions, I just put the person's initials next to the title. They were already there on the other one. See how this says vacant, BW, vacant, KP, VL. I noticed that today. I wasn't consistent. So I added the initials next to it, person's name. That's the only change. Dollars, everything else is the same on that page.
Okay, there's no reason you can't, but with the real estate that's here, you should be able to take this and add the actual names into the column, in a separate column. Just not for this year, it's good enough. Just make sure, but moving forward, like this step column.
Add another column. Okay.
Yeah, with the actual name. That way there'll be no questions. If you need some help with Excel, just let me know. I can.
Yeah, this whole.
I can wizard that up pretty easy. Like the non-union column, that can, you know, wrap the title and squish it down. You've got plenty of real estate.
Sure.
Yeah,
so that
this entire sheet should be on one page, and you can.
It is. It's just
print
I have.
It should be on one page. So.
It is. When I went to print it out, I accidentally, instead of highlighting
okay. right.
the
gotcha.
Whole thing, I skipped it and started in this column. That's it.
Okay.
And I went like this,
right.
and I missed it. That was my mistake. It is on one sheet. So the dollar amount, nothing changed. It's just whatever you see in yellow is what I added.
Weren't we going to remove a salary?
That would be up to you. I have not heard back whether if the board removes a salary,
mm-hmm.
If you can post because you don't have the funding. We're still waiting on getting the answers back to whether you can, you
it
know.
It actually serves no purpose to do that.
Transfer the money. I don't think you can. I don't know.
Well, per the FinCom and the Selectmen, they wanted us to.
No, they didn't.
No,
yep.
just $100,000.
I thought they said the $50,000. They wanted one of these
nope.
positions.
Nope.
The
they didn't vote that.
That's
I watched both meetings.
Yeah, voted at the Board of Selectmen meeting, and that was the recommendation of Selectman Peterson.
But it wasn't voted.
But it was not voted on.
So they didn't insist on it.
Right.
So. My discussion here I want to bring up is that we've been those recs have been open for a year, right?
Mm-hmm.
We've posted, we've gotten
actually the assistant distribution was here until what November.
Who was that? Bob Gray?
John Carey.
So I mean, it's not like it has been vacant. We remember, we're having trouble getting licensed, so I suggested that we go and get somebody that isn't licensed and bring them up so they
yeah.
can. So then we hired that one. So if
yeah.
John hadn't resigned, we'd be in pretty decent shape in distribution.
Mm-hmm.
The one suggestion I might have is maybe reduce the requirements and get somebody like with a D1 license as opposed to D2, and just so they can work towards their D2.
Well, one, we'd have to revote, I think, the job description, go through that whole rigmarole with town.
You have to approach the union because you're going to be getting rid of assistant supervisors.
Not getting rid of, just not funding. Not
no,
talking about
no,
eliminating positions.
Talking about what Mark is saying, you wouldn't
just
fund.
Changing it.
You wouldn't,
because we're obviously
you would
not finding
it. Eliminating
anybody.
That position to create a new position in the department.
To modify a position. When
yes.
say create a new one, we're going to modify an existing.
But you couldn't call that person an assistant distribution supervisor.
Why?
You would have to be a laborer.
We could not change the job description?
We have a laborer's position.
No, that's not my question. Given the assistant chief operator, if we changed the requirements and talked to the union and made sure they were okay with it, could we still call it an assistant chief operator?
No.
Are those requirements from the DEP that you have to have XYZ?
The idea is that the distribution foreman and the assistant distribution foreman are the primary and secondary for the department. They're
mm-hmm.
they're responsible for the distribution and would be listed with the DEP. So you wouldn't be able to call. I mean, the board can create whatever position you want, but you wouldn't be able to call that modify the distribution assistant foreman's position. It would not be. It could not be supervisor.
So the assistant chief operator is Michael Flower there. I see line 9.
Yeah.
Where's the open rec for his backup? I can't see it on this document, so.
Water treatment plant. It's just a regular water treatment plant operator.
And that's the one that's vacant?
That
mm-hmm.
one is vacant, yes.
Yeah.
And what's the other one that's vacant?
The assistant distribution working foreman, and we are making an offer to a candidate for the janitor, so.
Okay, I'm not worried about. So, the distribution working foreman, is that the one that John Carey was?
Yes.
All right.
That's the one I'm talking about.
All right. So, with regards to the water treatment plant operator, We've been going out without that for quite a while, correct? That seems to me like a likely candidate to my words, defund. Maintain it, but defund it. And then if we run into it, I mean, we're not going to search for it.
So that would bring the wages down to 440.
So let me just make sure I understand. What are the DEP requirements for a secondary operator?
They fill the role of the primary operator in the primary operator's absence.
Right. So does that mean to say they have to have the same qualifications as the primary operator?
The licensing is the same because we of this type of system we are. We're a D2 system, T2 system. So that's what they have to have.
And can you go back to the other sheet? So it's not done.
The Form 2.
Wherever we were. Yeah, Form 2.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. And so the net effect. And
which way do you want me to scroll?
Yeah, what? Just.
Left or right, sorry.
Left a little bit more. And what's the one you zeroed out?
This one.
Okay. Who's doing that function? Who's backing that up now as the water treatment operator? So when, what is it, LaFleur is out? Who's doing that?
Well, for example, yesterday I had one person all day.
Who?
Rob.
Right, so that's my question is,
he had to do everything.
So, okay, it's going to happen. But so right now, without that position being filled, who's doing the work? Mike and Rob?
Mike and Rob, yes.
Okay. And they've been doing that for how long?
I don't recall how long.
It's been a long time.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why I think if we're not getting resumes, you're saying no one's going to take the job, so on and so forth. So in this case, we're not going to eliminate it, but we'll defund it for this budget.
Mm-hmm.
And if we find out we need it and we get great candidates, we'll go back to the FinCom and the selectmen and say, well, we've got someone. And
the problem is going to take a town meeting to do it, to refund it.
To refund it?
Yes.
So be it.
But if you leave it there, the money is going to be there anyways. Because
mm-hmm.
we're going to get it in it. So the only thing you're doing is restricting us from being able to hire anybody for a year.
At
the end of the year.
Partially.
At the end of the year, that money's still going to be there because we're not going to change the rates without the rate study.
That too, but we're also getting feedback from, I'll say the town, that they're looking for us to be more fiscally conservative. And by carrying that money on the books, that
it's still on the books, though. That's what I'm getting at.
No, if we don't...
It's going to come in as income.
That $50,000?
Yes.
No, that's a salary. That's an expense.
Right.
That's a wage expense.
Exactly.
Right, and if you eliminate that expense, that's off the books.
It's off the books, but when you get your money in anyways from all your water bills,
mm-hmm.
you're not eliminating that money off the water bills. See what I'm saying?
Well, right. However, down the road, depending on the rate study, and there is a hue and cry, and I want to see if we actually do have $1 million. If we do, we need to re-examine the rates.
We don't have money.
And the trend can go up.
I think that's why we have it in to do a rate study.
It can go up or down.
Exactly.
Yep.
But I think for this fiscal year, you're tying our hands that if we do find a candidate, we're not going to be able to hire him because the money's not allocated for it.
I can't advertise without a position being funded.
Mm-hmm. I know.
Okay. So if somebody walks through the door on July 1, I cannot hire him.
And my point being that, we haven't had anybody for over a year.
Right, not that they're going to, but I'm saying.
Right, and I understand, but Bernie, what's your opinion on this?
Well, if as we look at the operations, that position is needed, then that slot should be covered in the budget. And it should be transparently visible in the budget as well. I mean, if So the issue for me is this position, is there any workaround for the position? If there's a workaround for the position, then take the position out of the budget. There's no workaround, and we are going to be constantly looking for this position to fill, then it should be in the budget. But obviously, you know, we should recognize the unspent money sooner rather than later as we're going ahead. So this year, we had the position filled through November.
That was the assistant distribution worker.
That's the other position we're talking about.
So this position has not been filled at all.
Well, it was. We had Rob, Mike, and Bob Gray were in those positions. Bob Gray left in August, so Bob Gray was the assistant chief operator.
Mm-hmm.
Rob was the primary, and Michael LaFlower was this water treatment plant operator too. When Bob left, we promoted Michael into the assistant chief's job, and this position has only been vacant since August.
So, okay. I mean, they've all, that all the positions have been filled at one point or another.
So we didn't
just not all at once.
Licenses?
Yes.
Well, I'd be inclined to just leave it as is this year, but with the proviso that next year, if those two are empty,
I agree.
It's going to be a real hard conversation at budget time. So,
mm-hmm.
So we'll just leave it as is.
I absolutely concur with that because that goes back to the issue about to what extent do we need this position, and then if we drop that position, what's the contingency? Because it will create a contingency. Otherwise, we wouldn't have had the position at all.
Yeah. All right. Let's move on to the next part.
It's back in.
Well, I have another question.
Okay.
And that is, we're at the selectmen's meeting, when we were going through this, there was an issue about the number of vacation days and the calculations.
Okay, that's the next form we're going to go on.
Okay.
Are we ready to move on to the OT calcs?
Yep.
Okay, so the entire form is yellow because I redid the entire overtime sheet based upon some of the feedback and comment. And it wasn't that I didn't understand this sheet. I did not create the sheet. It was created by two or three people before me, and this was the budget that I was handed to follow. I didn't agree with that form because what that form did, it was more complicated than what you actually saw. They were calculating out every single individual person's overtime, including the administrative assistant, and they had $160,000 in the overtime line. So I began to cut it. So this is what I'm more used to looking at as far as preparing. This can be modified and changed however anybody wants, but the first section, the on-call, that's the for them to be on call, to take the pager, to go home. We have on call for the distribution operators. We have your scheduled overtime and unscheduled overtime. And we have to pay a minimum of 4-hour call out
mm-hmm.
when they respond to emergencies. And not knowing who is going to respond to those emergencies, I've used the highest overtime rate, so that way it will cover the person who gets the $52.25 an hour, to keep it simple. Up above the $33.33 is what the on-call operator is paid per the union contract Monday through Friday. Per the union contract, they get $50 on Saturday, $50 on Sunday, and then $50 if they work on holiday. So Bernie, what they were talking about was the number of days. So there are 253 days that they get paid, $33.33, 100 days at $50. And we have 11 holidays on the books, but there's actually 12 because the day after Thanksgiving, is a personal day, but that person has to be on call. So that's a $50. That's a $50. That's for that extra day. So when you add all those up, it's 365 days.
I find this one very easy to follow.
Right. So could you just put an asterisk on the 12 holidays and explain that to a third party?
And what was the question previously from the other bodies?
They didn't understand the number of days.
They didn't understand the number of days. Again, it was, I don't know what the, I can't speak to what the number of days that were in there because I didn't put them in there.
Okay.
It was a spreadsheet that was...
So you now have corrected it?
I've changed it. This is brand new. To make it simpler, I mean, I think it's simpler. I think it works.
I find it very easy to follow. I don't know.
Yeah, it makes complete sense.
Yeah. The only question I would have had was the 12 instead of 11. To explain that.
Bernie's putting the asterisk in that explains that. Keep people from wondering why.
Mm-hmm.
Why, so...
Well, I think some people
thought holiday per
the water department was getting an extra day off. That's what the issue was.
So.
Well, they actually do.
Yeah.
Everybody's the same. I think that number was actually different from 12. I think it was a bigger than the original, but I don't...
Hey, what happened there? Hey, what happened?
I hate when that happens.
Undo.
No, I didn't do anything to it. I don't know what happened to it. I just have to fix it. Because that will affect Form 1 if it's not in there, right? Yeah. So I don't know what I did, but something helped. I can fix that.
I think when you put the asterisk...
Oh, it times it.
Well, it also took it to 353 days versus 365.
I think I might... you know what? I'm trying to type on that.
You know, go to 12. Okay. Oh, yeah, hard code it. Okay. Let's see, take out the. You can do a. Yeah, it'll blow your thing out.
Just color it.
So, what I'll do is, I will break out. I'll do it right now because, since we're here, because I have to have the approved budget. So, any changes I make, I want you to see these. And so, what I'm going to do is, I'm going to put one at 50. Sorry. Oops. And then I'll put the, I can't put an asterisk, but I can make a note over here next to it, outside in the margin.
Yep.
Is that okay if I put that out in the margin like that, John?
Yes.
So I do have a question on the unscheduled
overtime. I
can
fix it down here too.
Also, where it says standby 12 holidays.
I just saw that. Yep.
Yeah.
Oh, actually, I can put it right there.
It's all right. I can't type without pressure.
Okay.
And just standby 12 should be 11. You got to change the text in both columns.
I'm sorry, John, what was that?
Finish what you're doing. Okay. Your text where it says standby 12 holidays in both places, standby 11.
11?
Over the 11.
Text.
Oh.
The text.
Yep. Column. Thank you. Mm-hmm.
that better?
Yeah.
I mean, that
sense.
Does break it down a little further. I think it's much better.
It's people that don't work in the system actually can realize what it's about.
So I have questions.
Sure.
What's the rule of thumb for determining call-outs?
Looked at the number of call-outs over the past couple. I mean, you can change that. We can change that to 10 call-outs.
What makes them get called out? Sorry?
What makes them get called out?
No, I understand what might get them
we
called
track
out.
It.
What's the number?
We track
the
it.
The number 50.
How many times?
I'm always suspicious of round numbers. So I don't mind round numbers as
long as
there's a rationale behind the
when you're doing it, it's just a guess.
No, it's not a guess. I know exactly how many call-outs we
You don't know exactly how many call-outs you're going to get in the next 365 days.
No,
I guarantee you that.
No, from the previous year is what I'm saying.
Yeah.
All I'm asking is what's your rule of thumb for coming up with 50?
Based on the last year or two,
best
correct?
On history, to guess.
On history.
So, given the level of scrutiny that we're getting, I would, at a minimum, put that explanation in. Ideally, I will put in what it was in 2016 and 2015 in the note column, so that people understand that we're not pulling these just out of the air, that there's a rationale for putting in the 50. And I agree, we can't project. It could be down to 10 or it could be up to 100.
Now, I will tell you that right now we are way under. I don't want to jinx anything, but we're way under on call-outs, I know. For this year, we do not have the amount of call-outs right now in this fiscal year as we had the year before.
Okay, so
it's hard to say.
It's a little different than trying to predict when there's a fire call.
That's basically averages 1 a week. Mm-hmm. Looking at that, that's about 1 a week.
That's pretty much.
It's a pretty average gauge.
Right, but I understand that, but when you have a call-out, how many people get called out?
One, sometimes all of them.
Right. So I think that's you could put in the rule of thumb, 1 a week. I'm not as concerned about that as long as there's a clear rationale so that people understand that we just haven't pulled the number 50 out of the air. I'm more concerned, actually, with the 400 on the unscheduled overtime.
I think there needs to be an explanation as to what the difference is between scheduled and unscheduled.
That's another good point.
So on Saturdays and Sundays, it's a minimum of 4 hours that they have to work.
I put the asterisk per union contract. Just again.
Oh, I can't put the I can't because it changes the math.
No, but the text is with Saturday, Sunday, but right after that. But that's the same reason.
Oh, I should probably do
contract.
That up here.
Mm-hmm.
But that's 4 hours for what?
They have to work.
They have to come in and do the pump stations.
Yeah.
Even though we have somebody here working on weekends.
So here's the other thing. We have a person that works on the weekends, however. If that person is sick, which actually
they had
to come in and work on Saturday and Sunday, you can change that number.
I just think it's scheduled and unscheduled needs an explanation.
So
people that aren't involved, they can understand what it is.
Okay.
I know what it is, but I just think it needs to be.
Well, unscheduled is for emergencies, right?
Mm-hmm. But so, they both say emergency call, scheduled, unscheduled.
So we're looking at 50, and then we're looking at 100. So.
Schedule missed bill.
Typing with the band-aid on my finger.
All right. What does that mean?
You
just wrote scheduled and unscheduled, but.
But I know. I'm going to. You wanted a definition. I thought you wanted me to put a definition.
Oh, to explain what that was. That's what I'm doing.
Oh, I thought you were done. I'm like, no. Okay. Carry on.
So on the scheduled overtime currently, you have 4 hour minimum call out, 200 under that, and the math suggests that that's 200 hours. So either label it as 200 hours or label it as 50 call outs. One.
Where? Which line?
But you see, Bernie, it's already there. It says that in the previous call.
Okay.
50 call-outs at four hours equals 200 hours. So when you're reading the aisle, you're going across. And
I can't put any words in there because this is an Excel spreadsheet and it calculates across. If you put anything in there, it won't.
Okay.
It only does what it tells you.
So on the unscheduled overtime, then add the same, that assumes 100 call-outs, 100 Saturday and Sunday call-outs. That doesn't make, that says you're going to get called out on a weekend, every day of a week, of every weekend day you're going to get called out.
That's what that.
Called out.
But that, if there's 52 weeks, that's 104 days. 104 weekend days, and you're saying that almost every weekend you're called out? I mean, we can certainly, Mary Beth, you can go and research this if you want. We could do the final vote Tuesday.
I have to get this in, the what we're holding up, the warrant.
They can wait. I mean, if we're going to go through this kind of machinations, I mean, it's not, while you do this nonstop, the rest of us have got other activities that fund our ability to do this. But that
so the bottom line on both the scheduled overtime and the unscheduled overtime is we need a clear rationale for the number of actual call outs
for weekends.
Particularly for weekends, because the number doesn't make any sense. It's not realistic.
Mm-hmm. They were backwards. So scheduled overtime is the four hours on Saturday and Sunday. And
how do you have emergency scheduled? That's what I don't understand. Okay, so you had the positions backwards.
Yes, I'm sorry.
So Saturdays and Sundays you get scheduled overtime?
That's where they come into work.
That's
at the treatment facility.
Okay.
And for unscheduled is callouts, 50 Esquire. Mm-hmm. That makes Y 100 and 200. What's the two numbers there? Emergency callouts, 100. Yeah, that's not right. So line 20 and 21, column B, those numbers don't jive. So if you got emergency callouts unscheduled, 100, then you have 50 callouts, 200.
It's all right. So this is the four. This is all right. This is the four. They get a minimum of 4 hours, whether they respond and it takes them 10 minutes, or if it takes them 3 hours, they get 4 hour minimum call out. Mm-hmm. That's what the 4 hour minimum call out would be. 200.
Right, we understand that.
Okay.
The issue is the number.
What's the 100 and the 200?
You've got currently under scheduled overtime.
It's hours.
You've got 50 call outs. So the issue was, what's the rationale for the 50? The unscheduled overtime, you've got essentially 100 call outs. That 100 shouldn't be in that column, I assume.
Well, is it 100 call outs or 100 hours? Because if that's the case, you're mixing, you're tricky mixing things up.
Because there's, then there's a,
because you've got 400 hours up above.
And then it calculates, and you've got another $5,000 in the overtime.
That just, that whole little block doesn't make sense to me. So unscheduled callouts,
mm-hmm.
You're saying there's 100? Or you're saying there's 25 unscheduled callouts. So one every other week.
Yeah, but how is it?
I just don't know.
All right,
I don't
so
know
you
why
guys
those
are confusing me now. So scheduled overtime is if, for example, we're going to flush.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to do that from 6 o'clock to midnight. That's scheduled overtime.
Mm-hmm.
And take out emergency callouts. It doesn't make any sense. If it's scheduled, it's fine that it's scheduled overtime, but it's not an emergency callout. It's planned overtime.
Mm-hmm. But that's,
because that needs to go up here then.
Yeah, that's that. It needs to be under scheduled.
So standard planned overtime, you have 100 hours. Is that what you're
saying? So what you're saying is you got the 400 hours for the treatment facility, and there's 100 hours for planned distribution overtime, such as flushing hydrants. Okay, it's making more sense now. And now you go under, you have 50 calls for emergency overtime at 200 hours.
Yeah.
That's making sense now.
So on Saturday and Sunday, we staff 4 hours over. We plan on 4 hours of overtime every weekend day for the water treatment plant?
I do, because what if Bob Walsh quits today? You won't have money to cover the weekends. Right now you have a part-time operator working Saturday and Sunday. If you don't want to fund that, we can fix that. It's not a problem. But then if, Bob Walsh he's been taking some time off, the other operators have to take that shift. So if you don't
mm-hmm.
want to have that in there, we can certainly take it out.
So.
But I'll end up being over. You know, Bob.
It needs to be in there just on the fact that, like I said, he could be off for the weekend. He may need help. Whatever.
It just needs to be All right, Beth, it just needs to be correctly labeled so that...
Okay, I have no problem. What would you like me to label it?
What it is. If this 400 hours is backup for the part-time operator, then that's what we should call it, anticipated backup for the part-time operator. Then the issue would be, well, why is it 400 hours? I mean, what do we assume? What's the assumption behind that? I mean, he needs backup every weekend, both days. So that's what the numbers say, right?
Mm-hmm. Okay, so there are 100 weekend days.
No, there's 200.
How many weekend
days?
104.
104.
Okay, so if there's 104 weekend days, oh, I think I based it on 100. It's 4 hours times the weekend. 400.
Now, how does it work on holidays? Who runs the treatment plant on holidays?
The person on call.
So they have to pay. They're there for probably more than 4 hours, right?
No, we only require them to work the 4 hours on Saturday. I mean, on holiday. So
you have to add that in, that as part of the Saturday and Sunday 4 hour.
You want to add 11 days for the holiday?
Oh, I'm just saying that's. I'm sure that's what you're spending some of it on.
Yes. So, Mr. Cullen, what is it that you want me? I apologize. What was it that you wanted me to change the label?
I want any third party who's looking at this sheet to understand what these numbers are, and they're not confused like I am right at the moment. So Saturday and Sunday under unscheduled overtime, what does it actually refer to?
Oh, you said...
I mean, at this moment, it says to me that every Saturday and Sunday, somebody is working overtime at the water treatment plant.
Yes, if you would like to interpret it that way, yes. So what I'm saying is, we don't have to do that, but I'm planning to have funding to cover in the event we lose the weekend operator and we have to cover the shift.
Then you need to an estimate that's more supportable than every Saturday and Sunday. In other words, you assume that it's 1 week a month, 5 weeks a quarter, whatever it is, but every weekend just doesn't make sense.
Okay, well, that's what I'm saying, is that
Mary Beth, you understand what the ebb and flow of activities are, how many times a part-time operator doesn't show or it needs additional support. I don't have that.
Mm-hmm.
But I do know any forensic accountant would say, whoa, that number doesn't make sense. That looks like a made-up number. And what we're getting is from feedback from the finance committee and the selectmen is they don't want made up numbers, even though there's a perfect, you've got a reasonable rationale for saying we need some flexibility, we need to build in some buffer into the budget to allow for certain events which we know occur, like the part-time person doesn't show up or is off for whatever reason. But it can't be every Saturday and Sunday.
So you want to call it backup weekend work or
weekend and holiday?
We can call it whatever you
weekend
want.
Weekend and holiday treatment facility coverage.
Right.
You would probably describe it better.
You can describe it better, but that number, it can't be every... Am I just making a mountain out of...
No, the question is, you're saying that you want to have money available in case there's a problem any weekend,
correct?
Well, we agree with that.
Based on what you've said before, is in the past years, how much have you spent on that? Has it been every weekend?
No. I said it wasn't every weekend. The past month, Bob Walsh has been off on the weekends. He's having problems where he's at, and he had to work at his other job.
So I guess the question is, based on your experience with your team over the last year, is what's a more accurate estimation? Because you do have to estimate, but...
Well, I don't have that in front of me at the moment, but if my intent here was to have money available for full coverage for the entire year in the event we lost the weekend operator. If the board doesn't want to carry that, we don't have to. We don't have to carry that. But if he doesn't work, then I won't. Then the budget will be over in the salaries line.
What we want is a more accurate estimation. Okay, you need the tools to run the department, and what we're saying is that budgeting for every weekend appears excessive.
It does.
And so we're looking for a more accurate estimate.
Okay.
We're not tying your hands, we just want a more accurate estimate. And that's why I said, I think, you know, we'll have to push forward and just take the beating about not delivering this week. So it's still March, we have time. Not a lot, but we have time. Do you agree? Give her a chance.
Yeah, it needs a better explanation. Like I said, it needs, you know, coverage for holidays and weekends are included in that. But not, you know, we have part-time, but he's not there all the time because nobody can work 7 days a week, 52 weeks a year.
So just maybe just call it weekend coverage.
Weekend and holiday. That way you cover your 11 holidays, plus one.
Okay.
And then just come back with a more, you may come back and say, you know what, that is the right estimate.
But you might need more.
I want you to have confidence in that number. Mm-hmm. That's all.
If Mr. Peterson asks you the question, you have to have a much snappier answer than I'm.
You're on camera.
No, but
But that's the reason.
It's important that we are confident about where these numbers are and that they're justified. I don't have any problem at all putting any number in here, but we need to have a clear rationale for it.
And pursuant to the FinCom meeting, and I said, I don't know if you guys saw it or not, but I made the statement that, you know, we've gone through it. Mary Beth has got a good grip on this budget. The first time last year was the second. This is the third. Only my second. And that the way I manage is to the southeast corner. That's an accountant's expression. And that we've kept spending down. How that spending is done within the bucket is in question, and I think that's what Bernie's referring to too. We need to give them the confidence that you get your hands around the throat of the budget. That's all. And that's what we're doing now. And Jamie, I officially thank you for your backing your statement at the meeting as well. So
I meant a lot. I would second that because that was a very pleasant ending to what was in. Not necessarily. It was slightly embarrassing that I wasn't even there. I was watching it on video. But thank you.
You're welcome.
Try sitting there. That's fine. All right. So Mary Beth, you know what we're looking for there?
I do.
Okay. Let's move on to the next thing.
What I'll do is,
and if you want to check it out, just I'm around. Just call me.
I was just going to say that I will make the changes, and I will be calling you, Bernie. Move on to the expense sheet.
Yeah, sure. Well, everybody good with this? Move on?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay, good. Expense, debt,
So this was the, this is the maintenance line that both FinCom and the selectmen wanted us to cut by $100,000. So I had already made some cuts prior to the additional 100, and I left those in. I didn't include those as part of the 100,000. So if you allow me to go through this. So on this page, anything that you see that is highlighted in yellow has been cut. So if you just quickly scroll down, almost everything in the budget has been cut. $215,400 is what I cut that maintenance line by. And part of it, if we scroll back up, let's see, can't do that. All right. So the first thing, and I mentioned this early on, engineering. You see there's nothing funded in it, in the maintenance line, zero, because I moved it to Form 1, engineering, $50,000.
So you cut it in half?
I'm sorry?
You cut it in half?
Well, there seemed to be a problem with the 100, so I did. Okay. What I did was I ended up, that was what was originally in the town meeting was the, we had, it used to be over here, and it was, and so I cut it in half, engineering. So if we go back to the expense page, second thing I did was...
Well, hold on, let's take it slowly so a slower folks can make sure we know exactly what we're looking at. So on this sheet, it's under services. So the outside services is now sitting at 100,000. Is that correct? On my sheet. This is line 33.
No, correct. That's
line
correct.
Line 33.
But we're talking about the engineering. We're on that services, engineering.
It's gone to zero.
We're zero.
Now, has that been completely removed? You didn't put that somewhere else? It says move to line...
Right, move to line 7, which if you follow the screen, I'm going back onto Form 1. This is the form that goes to town meeting. The $50,000, I cut the engineering money in half, $50,000, and I put it here. This is the paper that... This is the form that goes to town meeting. It used... This is what they were talking about. This used to be on the form when it went to town meeting. And because in the budget... There were two lines that had engineering. Line 7 over here on the budget, it had money, and then there was money also in the line 7. There were two lines. So I didn't want to have two separate accounts for engineering services. So we tried in last year's budget was to, if you see the zero in FY17, instead of putting in the money here and in the maintenance line, I took it out of here and put it all in the maintenance line, but then now they don't want it in the maintenance line. We put it back where it was.
Okay.
So here's my confusion. So you've got on your detailed sheet.
Which sheet? Form 1, Bernie? This one? Or are we going to the expense? Okay, we're on expense.
Expense.
You've got engineering and outside as two separate categories here. And then when you go to the summary sheet, you've got engineering / outside services. So
this should only, this was what it was. I can take the, I thought I took that out. This is supposed to be engineering services only.
Okay.
They're two separate things.
Change it then.
Please.
Because that sends a completely different message.
I just caught that when we were talking.
Well, it's not only that, it's that there's a tie back to, there's a $100,000 detail item that still exists. as outside services. So I'm assuming that is into the.
So you reduced engineering to zero, and then outside you have 100,000, which is increased by 50 from last year. But if you go to the other form we were just looking at,
somewhere.
Form one, yeah. Now engineering services says 50. That doesn't jive with what we've got in the details here.
Okay,
because you've got outside is 100.
So because in order, this master sheet form one is tied to all those spreadsheets that are behind it, okay? So we cannot, on the expense line, remove anything. So until there are three zeros across here. So next year, when we do the budget, this will still have to stay here, but this will be, the numbers will change. It'll be FY17, FY18, and then it'll be the FY19. Until there are three zeros, like here, for example.
No, stop on this. Go back to outside services, engineering. There's $100,000 there.
Right.
Now go back to Form 1. And that says 50,000.
It's two separate things.
Okay.
Outside services. I'm sorry, go ahead.
If I
was on the finance committee, I would immediately ask, where are you counting the 100,000?
Where's the other 50?
And where's the 50? That's good.
Yeah. There's 50 for
so
engineering services.
So we're talking about.
Where's the other 50?
Two separate things.
Where's the other 50?
What other 50?
Go back. Okay, you've got $100,000 there, right? Okay, now go back to Form 1. It says 50,000. That's a difference of 50.
She's saying
there's two. It's two separate, completely different accounts. Engineering services and outside services are two individual, independent, separate things.
Okay. Then where's the 100,000 on this sheet?
Oh, okay, so it's not. All right, so Form 1 is what goes to town meeting.
Mm-hmm.
All the other forms are for the boards and commissions. It's the backup to this sheet.
Right, so that's what, I accept that. That's fine.
Okay.
So is the 100,000 of
the
outside services in the maintenance
is
line?
Is right here.
In the maintenance line. Okay.
The 100,000 on the expense sheet shows up in the 698.
Okay.
Which, if you go down to the bottom of this spreadsheet, there's a 698.48. It's included in that number on Form 1. Down the road, which we can talk about, which we're going to talk about later, is putting more of the breakout, what you're talking about, on the Form 1. We can't do it now. There's just not enough time to reinvent the entire Form 1.
Fine.
So, I have an example that I prepared in your packet to what I think I understand what it was that was being asked of us.
Mm-hmm.
For future, which we'll work on for FY19.
So, can you see why there would be confusion if someone's looking at that?
I don't.
Oh, I...
Can we go back? I don't.
Yeah.
James,
yeah.
I do.
Yeah, it's extremely
well, can you help me then?
Misleading.
I don't understand.
Well, if it says outside services 100,000 there, where does that show up?
On it's the down page? To the bottom.
In the 600.
It doesn't.
Individually, no,
it's not broken.
It's not.
It's not
down
broken
the road
up.
For FY19, yes it will.
That's maintenance.
A big number.
This $100,000 right here. If I was to put a zero in there right now,
mm-hmm.
Let's go back to Form 1. It changes it to 598. There's your 100,000. It's showing up in the Water Department maintenance, which comes, scroll down to the total of line 7. There it is. The 100,000 is in the Water Department maintenance line.
So go back to
That's why this has so many sub-accounts.
Yeah. Go back to Form 1.
So you can see the detail.
Please correct that, Mary Beth, before we lose track of it.
Oh, yes. Yeah, pop that back.
Oh, I wouldn't let that one go. I need that.
No, that's a million, okay.
And so go back to Form 1.
Okay, hold on, say, Form 1.
Now, you're saying that engineering services, what if you just put engineering slash outside services and made that 150,000 and took it out of the...
I can do that too.
I mean, wouldn't that be clearer?
I could do that as well. I actually almost did that, but I didn't.
So before we make that change, which I think is a reasonable change, the 100,000 for outside services is estimated on what basis?
I was just going to say, what's the justification?
Well, you have all of that in your budget book, all the backup to that, all the contracts that we do, the annual service and all that.
But we're looking to you. You built it, if you can give us a summary quick.
Well, I can't give you a summary. You have to pull out my budget book and look to the contracts. It's building maintenance. If we have to do something, like, for example, when we bricked in the hole in the wall, that's outside services for the mason.
So 100,000, though, that's huge for outside services.
It's not. We don't have a full staff. So if I have an emergency, I have to call Pike Construction in to do...
Is the 70,000 for the contract operator in that, outside services?
We don't have contract operations. We don't have any money for contract operations in the budget.
We have someone in here that we authorized like a 10 or 14 weeks for an operator.
We took that out of outside services.
You took that out of outside services?
Yes.
So is that, do you plan to continue funding that in outside services for FY18?
No, that was an unplanned expense. Having to hire the contract operator was an unplanned expense.
Mm-hmm.
And because... we unfunded the, what was it called, something treatment, it used to be in the budget, something treatment. And it was a place where in the budget on the Form 1 where they had the money for the contract operations when you had Weston and Sampson coming in here running the department for you. But that's been unfunded and it's not part of the budget anymore.
So
the only option we had... in order for me to be able to do that was to take it out of outside services.
Okay. And so if we took that... So again, what's making up outside services? I guess I'd want to break down for next week. Because if we get a town meeting, people ask, that's right. going to be a hard question.
It's a big bucket. All we need is the kind of throw by the end. What are the three or four categories that fill up 80% of that budget? It is not bricking in a wall. It's
Robert Pike Construction for all the main breaks and hydrant repairs.
Mm-hmm. And what number
that's the bulk.
That?
That's the bulk of it. Then, is the contract operator? You have it in your packet.
Well, we do, but you have it. What number are you talking about?
Right now, we spent $118,676 on outside services.
And how much was that to main break? Main breaks.
Well, I don't have that number off the top of my head. I will have to go into the spreadsheet and pull them out.
Just guesstimate.
I'm not going to guesstimate because I have no idea.
But you're saying the majority of that you think is from Pike Construction?
Yeah, I'm looking at it. I can see it.
But the total of that is 118?
For outside services, year to date, we have spent $118,876.14 in outside services.
Okay. Next year, you've budgeted $100,000 for that.
Correct.
Okay. That's a reasonable explanation. So if someone says, what is that outside services? We're short two people. We can't get people to apply for the jobs. And right now, we're using Pike until we've... fully staffed. Now, my expectation is if you get those two positions filled, we should see that without contract services.
Absolutely. Oh, absolutely. No, that's driven because we need to have the help from outside to get some of the things done that we can't do. So yes, that number will drop when we get the positions filled.
So let's not call them out. Let's just call them outside services rather than outside contract services. Because
it's not. It is called outside services.
So, going back to Form 1, would it be better, and you've got it as engineering services, what did you say, Bernie, it's what? Just outside services?
No, put in slash outside services and put the 100 in here and unfund it in line 7.
No, in line 6.
Line 6, I'm sorry. Yeah. It was line 7, sorry.
So
you, is that what you want me to do?
You think that's reasonable?
I think I'm confused.
So, water department expense maintenance got that $100,000 for outside services.
Mm-hmm.
I'm saying change line 7 to say engineering slash outside services,
mm-hmm.
and put that 100 there. It'll be 150, and then reduce the water department expense maintenance line by 100.
Yep.
I think it's clearer.
Yeah.
It also, I mean, the ideal thing is whatever your budget categories are, they ought to have some management function. They ought to help you manage the business.
I think
so. That $150,000 becomes a target to manage.
The issue that both finance and selectmen had is with engineering services and the amount of money we're spending on engineering.
Mm-hmm.
So to add that with something else is like we're trying to hide more engineering.
Don't try to pull it out.
You know what I'm saying? Well, we're trying to disguise engineering money as something else.
Good point.
That's
I had that way.
I would take that.
And just leave it as is, and mm-hmm. when people go, why is that there? You know, damn if you do, damn if you don't.
Yeah, exactly.
At this stage, I give up. So
mm-hmm.
move forward.
But I just know that that's what's been over and over and over again.
Good point.
I think Mark is correct.
Yeah.
Move on. Wrong. Next item.
Mm-hmm.
Done. No, I'm done. Next.
Okay, so I did end up cutting this. Oh, so one of the things, the stuff in blue. So when I was going to prepare the budget, I noticed that some categories right here, the ones that are in blue, were in repair and maintenance, and it's not really repair and maintenance. This is the money, it's actually a supply. I need to correct that. It's a supply. So see, it was, I moved them where they belong. That's all I did. So if you'll notice, because there was not in the supply line before, there are zeros in FY16, zeros in FY17, and there's the money for 18. So see, I moved, there's my note, I moved those from the maintenance to the supply subaccount. The reason we have to leave them both in is because if we take them out, it messes up the two categories because there are numbers in there. And these numbers need to be here.
Historical numbers.
Historical mm-hmm. numbers. And that's all I did. Okay. There's no, see the zeros right here? Zero, zero,
so that's
zero.
That's an accounting enhancement. And the reason that they have to be reflected in both places is that there's historical numbers in there for the next 2 years running.
Yes.
And that when we get to the third fiscal year, those can be removed and left where they belong in supplies. That's the answer if someone has a question. Agreed? Mm-hmm. Right?
Yeah.
Okay.
It's a lot of good chart of accounts will save you a whole lot of problems.
One thing that is going up is the property insurance and it's out of our control and workers' comp, $45,000. But everything else, as you see, is either level funded or it. I did increase the employee miscellaneous. I guess when I was trying to. This particular line here is broken down to explain that big large number, and so I guess I created more confusion by trying to break down even further. So for example, employee miscellaneous, I had broken that down to put the training before. If you remember, I had in training, $4,000 for emergency ERP training, and then $500 per employee. Well, that was something I added to further break it out. So I got rid of it because the extra lines, Dennis had said I had added 39 lines. I don't believe it was 39. I think it was just because I moved some things around. So I put that training in the miscellaneous employee because there's no other category to put the training money. So that's why that line went up.
What else is in a miscellaneous?
Miscellaneous employee is their CEUs. Mm-hmm. That they go for, that's the $500 per employee for getting their contact hours required for their licensing. It's the $4,000 for the annual ERP. Mm-hmm. And I don't know, miscellaneous, whatever.
So I would change it to employee training. I hate the word miscellaneous. I don't know about you guys, but.
Yeah, miscellaneous is too broad.
I don't know if we can I just, can you? I don't know if we can change that because on prior fiscal years it doesn't say that. I think you would have to, you can't, I don't think you can change that.
But you can leave that, put zero in for this year, add another line that says admin employee training.
I can do that right now.
Yeah, that's fine. That'll address that mark.
Because I just, and you'll leave the historical issue with miscellaneous because it's wide open to anything.
Yeah. The other issue I have is that you had roughly, you know, 3,800 is roughly 4,000. And then you had 8,000, and now you've gone more. You've gone to 13 versus 12. That seems to be
okay.
A 25% increase over the
What
the
line are we talking about?
Line 68.
Okay.
So you get 3,888, roughly 4,000. The next year you've got 8,000, which is roughly double. And then you've got 13. Mm-hmm. So from a progression standpoint, you would really expect that to be 12,000. And that extra $1,000 is about a 25% jump over the previous year historical record, if that makes any sense to you.
I'll make it 12.
No, that's not what I want you to do.
Okay, so it was $4,000.
Yep.
For the $4,000 for the annual emergency response training. Mm-hmm. And then it was $500. It was $500 per employee. I think it was times seven employees, which was
$3,500.
$3,500. Thank you. $3,500.
$7,500.
So it was $7,500. So it should be go up, not down, if that.
Well, then you didn't do the emergency training in FY16.
We did.
So, but nothing else. You know what, I don't care about the past, but I mean, are we going to expect this to go with a 4,000 to 5,000 jump every fiscal
no,
year?
No, there wasn't any money. And so what happens is when we get an invoice in for something, we have to apply it to one of these sub-accounts. And okay. What was happening was this fee in general, you see what was happening. We charged $43,616 to fee in general. That's when I first started coming here.
Say a line. I can't see you.
I'm sorry. Line 66. Sorry. I'm sorry.
That's
I'm okay. Pointing at my laptop.
I know,
I'm sorry.
Yeah, okay.
But it's line 66. Yeah. And we spent $43,000 when I don't think there should be $43,000 in a
bucket.
Fee in
okay.
general.
Mm-hmm.
So
that's
what I was trying
miscellaneous.
Yeah, so what I was trying to do, which I guess I created more problems, was to look, I did. I looked at the fee in general and what we were charging, and we broke it out. Well, what was going into fee in general was the training, bank fees, things that, postage. So I was trying, there was enough dollars amount for each of those categories that would warrant a further breakout. So that created problems, so I took them out. I wasn't, because, oh, I know what it was, because with the way it was being looked at, I was adding more lines to this large breakout, which would give us more opportunity, I guess, to inflate the budget in other lines. I guess that's the way I looked at it. That's not what was happening, and if you look at the historical of the budget, I cut the budget last year. Before this, I already cut the budget, and now we further cut the budget, so that was never the intent. It was more, there's nowhere else to put an invoice. It's going to go to fee in general. Mm. And I don't budget $43,000. As you see, I'm trying to keep it. I'm trying. Well, I cut it because I had to come up with cutting. But
And adding more detail is not an opportunity to inflate the budget, because
there
are four other places in this town looking at the budget. The treasurer, the accountant, the FinCom, the selectmen, and this group. So more detail is never going to be a problem.
But okay. But it did. So I didn't. I took it out. I took this admin, and I took the fee in general, and I had bank services and fees. I had a postage. I had an employee training. The employee training, I forget what I had. I think I had added four or five sub accounts under the administrative to further break out that fee in general.
Yeah.
That's what I was doing, and I took them out because it caused problems.
So you need to finish on line 67. You just have admin written in there?
Yes. Okay. What did you want? I'm sorry. What did you want me to call that, Mr. Emery? I forgot.
What it is, training.
Oh. Thank you. Oh, thank you.
It's misspelled.
So we just ran through some calculations that said that number should be 7,500.
Yep.
No.
13,000.
You said 4,000 for...
I did. Oh, I did. I put it in. 7,500.
Yeah. Okay. So, and you also misspelled training. Yeah, I'll fix that. Yeah, so that's...
So now you've still got an employee miscellaneous line. And...
But it's been zeroed out.
No. Oh, you okay.
No, not yet.
Not yet. 8,000.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah.
You know, I don't know what that makes sense. Probably two. But we should just move two. Yeah. So at least we know what it is going for.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so we cannot get rid of employee miscellaneous because that is where they go for their, we pay for their CDL, their medical cards, what else is in here?
That's all contractual.
Licensing,
right?
So there'll be no money for us to pay for people to go and take their exams. That's what that's... just look
right,
at the detail.
You can change the employee training to training and licensing. I mean, that seems to be a perfectly coherent and cohesive mm-hmm. category that
yep.
you would manage.
So to date, we have spent $7,517 under employee miscellaneous.
Right, but how much of
but
that...
But if you change, just put it, like you said, change training / licensing.
Right.
That explains what it is.
Okay.
And put in a realistic figure.
So 7,500 plus exams, renewals, what have you.
But I would need more than $7,500.
That's why I said
that.
A realistic number.
Now put the correct
estimate.
We're not
arguing with you, Mary Beth, about...
No, I know.
We're just trying to make it so that
coherent.
People can understand what it actually is.
How much have you spent so far?
So I'd have to double that to 15.
Yeah, go ahead.
I don't understand why you double it. The fact is that we've got employee miscellaneous. Before you had 13,000, now we've got 15,000. We know that the actual training is 7,500. How much are we spending on licensing and roughly?
Year to date,
Under the employee miscellaneous category.
No, not the employee miscellaneous category.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
For licensing and people taking exams, how much have we spent?
Well, I'd have to look that up. I don't have that at the top of my head.
Right, but how much does a typical exam take cost?
I don't know. I don't know how. I haven't taken an exam in like 10 years.
So $2,000. I think that's enough.
Yeah. I was just gonna say for. If it was 13,000 before, it should be 13,000 now.
Right. That was your estimate.
Is that what you're, mm-hmm. is that what you're saying?
Yes.
Or
it's fine.
Okay.
We just basically didn't change it. We just changed the heading.
Labels.
Mr. Rolfe had a point, too, that training should be capitalized. Thank you. What's next?
Capital. This is, you voted on this back in this fall. This is what's going to town meeting. Any changes on this? Although
I know there's a lot of concern about the $50,000 put aside for the water main replacement.
I think you're going to, if you decide you don't want to do that, I think it's already on the warrant.
Oh.
You guys, remember like last year, you pulled the water use restriction bylaw,
mm-hmm.
redacted it, or whatever the correct.
Yeah.
You can do this, you can do the same thing with any of these things. I just think it's, I can check. Did you want to take that off if I can take it off?
I would.
I'm not sure.
Yeah, and the new source of supply?
All right, so I'm just going to highlight. So main replacement.
Mm-hmm.
And
new source of supply.
All right. If I can take those two out,
mm-hmm.
I will. But you may have to at town meeting stand up and say, you know, we want to relook at this or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. We'll wait till it's a crisis and then we'll ask for the money.
Now, the HVAC for 401 Central is on the special, correct?
Yes.
Because we're going to need the funds available as soon as possible so we can get this place workable.
Okay, that's a lousy last hour.
Mm-hmm. We haven't even got what we had before.
Yeah. Fans will do.
Okay. Nothing has changed on the debt calcs. Nothing has changed on the overhead. Mm-hmm. And this is the revenues page. The only thing I changed on this was adding in the free cash.
Okay.
And then a total. And that is it.
And what's the net effect on the budget from all the messing around then?
I'm sorry?
What's the net effect on the total budget last year to this year?
This grand total line, is that what
mm-hmm.
is that what you're looking for, John?
Yeah. I just can't see it clearly from here.
Overall, we've cut the budget this year $116,579.31.
Which is a net 4% decrease from last year.
Mm-hmm.
Given that we had a water emergency last year, that's significant. That's good. .2, .4, .3. And so the 115 is even over and above what the Selectmen and FinCom discussed.
Yes, because if you look at our overall budget, this section right in here, which is your debt,
mm-hmm.
it's going down. The debt is going down. So the budget is going down in general.
Well, so that's just 18,000.
See the debt subtotal?
Yeah.
Your debt's gone down $18,239.30.
As it should.
Yeah.
Just go up a little bit to the subtotal. Or further, go up, 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 up. There you go. So
everything's going down in general.
Well, so there'll be a point of diminishing returns, however.
The actual operating expenses have gone down how much?
$215,400.
Budget, the wages, expenses, and others, that total has gone down from $1,555,069.56 has gone to what?
What line are you on, Bernie?
I don't have a line. That's impossible.
What's the category on the far left? Wages and salary, expense, other?
Yeah, you're talking about the subtotal?
The total. Yeah.
This right here, the total, the subtotal of all these? This line right here?
Right, so that's okay. 1,450. So whatever changes we've just gone through have raised that by $60,000. I just want to double check. All right. Okay.
So should I put this on the agenda for next?
Next week?
Tuesday.
Yeah.
So can I? Which part of the budget is holding up the vote tonight? Just so I, is it the OT calcs, right? Part right here. You're not comfortable with this? Okay.
Yeah. No, it's 7:45. If you want to take a few minutes and see if you can figure that out, we can hang around.
I'm not a night person to begin with, and numbers, neither it's not going to work. So.
Now, the other question is, does this answer all of the questions that were given to us by the...
No.
Okay, so what's open?
So, we received two memos, one on March 13th and one on March 12th from the Board of Selectmen. Mm-hmm. And there were several things that needed to be... they had some concerns and questions that they had asked in the memo. When you go home in your packet, there is the example markup budget, which is kind of what they're looking for future, the detail at town meeting. So if you take a look at that, all right. So we need to respond to these two memos.
What is this? Are these real numbers in this mock-up?
No.
It's just giving me a heart attack.
No, I just...
We're not going to go to town meeting and say last year the budget was under 500,000 and this year it's over a million.
No, but this mock-up, the example of the new budget, that's what is... This doesn't have the bifurcation of things as discussed at the FinCom meeting. They wanted to have things...
Distribution, treatment, right.
Right.
I started working on that.
Okay, so right now, I'm not going to do anything with this.
No, that's just to say, this is to show you what it was they were more looking for. Basically, I need to rework another line 6 page with those 5 categories.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
So I emailed this memos to everybody, and I started pulling the information together. What I could find, I'm still working with the town accountant on the encumbrances. But for the memo dated March 12th, there were several questions that were asked about the contract with Net Technologies.
Mm-hmm.
They were questioning the date on the contract, stating that, did you sign this at a public meeting? The answer to the question is yes. June 28th, you have in your packet the June 28th agenda. And attached to that are the minutes. It's under General Business, Water Superintendent's Report, is where you sign the...
Let us catch up with you.
Sorry.
Is this in package one?
Yes, it was attached with the March 12th memo.
So is it with the March 12th memo documents?
Yes.
Okay. And what are we looking for?
I was just giving a brief overview of what the memo said, what they were looking for.
Right, but you said there's a document that shows XYZ. That's not a question.
June 28th agenda with the minutes attached. You discussed this under the water superintendent's report.
Yeah, that's not, I don't have that.
She said it's not in this package.
I've got a copy.
Okay. That's all right. If it's in here, I want to use it out of this.
Oh, okay. It's separate. It's down the pile a little bit further.
Okay.
Yeah, I clipped the documents that will go as part of the response to the memo.
Yeah, I don't see. Is it in the package once?
Yeah, it's, you get down two more stapled things and it's right there.
I could not find my car out there. It walked like this.
It is dark.
We had the major spotlights turned off. We can certainly leave them on during the meetings.
They definitely should
be. But from being a good neighbor standpoint, you know, we need to turn them off when we leave. But, you know, it is dark. I agree. But we have them. We can put them on, but we got to turn them off. Leaving them blazing all night long is a waste, and it's nasty.
I agree.
So we've talked about that. I do not have that document, guys, in this package. Yeah, I don't have that document you're referring to.
No, you need the right envelope.
Well, I said, is it package one?
I don't know what the package is called.
No, not you. Budget questions? Okay, so it's package two. That's what I asked. Is it package one or two? So,
it's in here.
Okay.
And you have two of the same memo, so...
That was in the first
package.
I know,
that's not the correct memo.
Okay. So, and it's attached to this?
It's in the pile. No, it's not attached.
Okay.
It should be the third one down in the pile. At least it was for me.
Okay. There we go. All right, so. So we have the selectman's memo, item number one. It's about a $38,000 budget 38, timing 50, shown attachment two, you encumbered three, invoices for 81, please attach to three. So this is the first one we're talking about?
Yeah, yes.
Okay, all right, so what's the story? So what's the story, Mary Beth? With these, what?
Well, I was starting to go over that.
Right, that's what I'm saying.
I was going to go over what I have. I don't have all of this because the board needs to have some input and help me answer these questions because I do not have the answer to the questions for all of them. I'm doing the best I can to gather what I can. So this is a response coming from the Board of Water Commissioners and the Water Superintendent. So I'm going to need some help. And that's what this meeting is partially about, is to work through some of these responses together. Mm-hmm. But I could tell you what I have. One of the questions in this memo, dated March 12th, was questioning the board. Did the board sign the Net Technologies contract?
Well, let's go through number two.
Why don't we just go through it one?
Okay.
Yeah, just take it from the top. Let's just do number one, go through there.
So I don't have the answer to number one. I'm working with the town accountant. But what you do have, which was a separate piece of paper, didn't make it into the order. It was placed on top of your packet. It's the encumbrance form from the town accountant. It had some numbers on it with dates of when the encumbrances were paid out for the projects that they're questioning. And it looks like this.
On top of
it was like it would have been on top of everything. Actually, you can have mine because I'll take that one. That's the light copy, if you don't mind.
No.
Okay.
Thanks. So the encumbrances.
So I just got these from the town accountant this afternoon.
Okay. So you prepared to go over these, or do you need to do some work on this first?
Well, this is just, this is what we encumbered of FY16 money. We encumbered these funds, and the selectmen are questioning this.
There's three, which three are they talking about?
So remember when I was saying that we had in FY16 there were two locations in the budget where there were engineering money. Mm-hmm. Line 7 on the FY16 budget, there was $50,000 in that line. If you go over into the attachment 3, attachment 1, there's $38,000 in the maintenance line. And that's why in this fiscal year, we got rid of the one that was on Form 1, when I was trying to say it was located in two different spots in the budget, and it was confusing, so we were trying to put it in one spot, which we did, but it ended up in the maintenance line, and now this year it's going to end up in another line of its own, separate.
Mm-hmm.
So what they're saying is that you can't encumber those funds.
Okay, I read the English, I understand what the words are saying, but I cannot make heads or tails of this mess. So, it is not clear, and I have done forensic accounting. So, it says town meeting approves $50,000 on attachment 2. So for FY16, there was $50,000 approved,
mm-hmm.
Right? You encumbered 3 invoices totaled 81.5. So which of the 3 on here equal 81.5? Anything that says take out? 1, 2, 3, there's 4. So which of the 4 make up the 81? Do we know?
Say 15, 47, 5, and 19.
Are you looking at this? Are you doing this?
Yeah. It's the 15,000.
Oh, you're reading the amount paid column.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
14,000, 47,500.
Yeah.
And the 19,000.
Okay.
comes to 66.5 plus 15, that's 81.5.
So 15.47.19, and we had budgeted, that was what we budgeted.
No.
We spent over a little bit over. So 19 versus 18.1.
No, no, when you say budgeted, I think this is where it's...
Oh, I'm sorry,
the language is so different.
The amount paid versus amount encumbered, is that what we're saying? When you just read off numbers, you're reading the amount paid?
Yes, I was looking at the amount paid, but if you add the two... But they're all going to Tater and Howard, and the numbers kind of round out. But their question is a technical question, I understand it, which is that we encumbered funds that were beyond somehow unauthorized, what they see as an authorized number. And I don't quite see it. If the 50,000 town meeting for attachment two, we had 88,000
encumbered, 86,000 actually.
They're looking at fiscal year budget.
Mm-hmm.
That's attachment two, and that says 50,000.
Right.
And then we spent 81,500
mm-hmm.
in the budget for fiscal year 16 that was submitted. At one of the breakouts only has 38,000 as engineering services. So there's a lack of, the numbers don't tie. So I think they're saying that we actually spent on Tater and Howard for engineering services, 81,500, yet we only had a budget for 50,000, so we should have, we're going to spend that money, we should have gone back to, for a warrant. Is that correct, Gina?
No. Oh, I'm sorry, Gina.
Is it probably a transfer that they were, to make sure it goes in the right line?
So we should have asked for transfer funds.
Well, we have...
If there was...
There were two locations in the budget that had money funded to it for engineering services. Line 7 on the FY16 budget had $50,000 in it.
Yeah.
Then one of the sub-accounts in the maintenance line had $38,000. So you had a total of $88,000 in engineering money combined.
But it only says 50 here. So are you saying that other money was up in line 6?
Correct.
Okay.
That's what I was trying to say. There was $88,000 combined in the budget.
So it was
but
the way that
we
reflected
spent,
the budget.
But we spent $49.09 of the $88,000 total. So just have to subtract the $28,849.09 from the $88,000. But the end of
six, you said.
I'm sorry?
You said 86.
Okay, all right. 88. Is that 86? I'm sorry, 88,000.
It's 50 plus
38.
That's 88.
Right. So you have to subtract $28,849.09, and that's what you had left.
60,000, 59.
59,150.
What was it, John?
59,150.
59. So that's what you have left in engineering money. So the invoices came to 81,500.
So we were short $21,000. 21,850. So again, is this an accounting issue that we just needed to move funds or request funds to be moved? And we missed it?
Or cannot do anything. FY16 budget is closed. You can't touch anything. We can't go into Peachtree.
No. It's just the explanation.
Oh. Okay.
We should have done something and didn't do it. Yes? No?
I guess
they're writing this up and they're saying, what are the invoices for? You can say what they're for. They're right there. Stormwater assistance, because that was unexpected with this. Water Management Act permitting, again, that was part of that. Hydraulic and capital efficiency plan, that's something we talked about. And then unidirectional flushing, we outsourced to do that. And so that's what it's for. And how can you encumber funds in excess of the budget line? So
your budget...
I don't know the encumbrance process specifically.
I can tell you.
Okay.
So towards the end of the fiscal year, you usually get a memo with a form attached, which is the form you see. That's the town accountant's encumbrance form.
Yep.
And it says, hey, department heads, going to pay your bills. We're going to close the books out. Anything you've got going on and you want to encumber your funds, you can encumber them. So you fill out that form, mm-hmm. and you turn them into the town accountant, and that's the process.
Okay.
And then the funds get encumbered, and then you can use FY16 funds to pay. For example, we had the water treatment plant flood. Mm-hmm. It happened on June 28th, all right? I immediately asked to encumber the $50,000 for the emergency and unforeseen, just in case we had anything that the insurance company wasn't going to pay. So we did that, the $50,000 on that. It turned out that the insurance company paid for almost all of it, and that what was left, we released the $50,000. I did not encumber it. It went back to wherever it came from. And I just paid the invoices that came in, because they were small, out of our current operating budget.
Mm-hmm.
So for example, if you... always get...
That's fine. I understand that. But the questions I have here is, what are they for? You've got the information there in the encumbrance form. You can tell them that. And how do we need a control in place to make sure that...
Well, the key thing with encumbrance, too, which you didn't mention, is the expense has to have been incurred by June 30th at midnight.
Okay.
So... just anything that's incurred after that, you cannot encumber funds for.
Mm-hmm.
Right, but what this issue, I read this issue as basically saying, you encumbered.
I think the question, I think...
But from where? From which budget line did you essentially use to encumber the funds? And they're saying the budget lines that make the most sense didn't have sufficient monies.
What I'm getting from reading this is they're questioning when we... actually made the expenditure for the security system, because some dates are before June 30th.
Number one, jump ahead.
We should start.
I just been reading the whole thing, so
okay. But number one,
and you talk about encumbrances, and that's one question that I see.
Yeah, we'll get there, but let's figure out number one. So they're saying, how do we encumber the funds in excess? We need to put a control in place to make sure that when we do an encumbrance, that we put it on the agenda and we look at the budget and we validate it before it gets encumbered.
The board discussed this on June 28th at a water board. That's what I was trying to tell you, that you guys talked about this, the encumbrances, and I explained to the board the process, and you have this in your packet. It's actually with the other memo. We took a photocopy of this out of the June 28th packet, where we talked about where the encumbrance money was going to come. I worked with the town accountant to come up with where we were going to take the money from in the budget to cover the costs of the deficit for we had that didn't SRF didn't cover.
The $28,000.
We went over this. And all that documentation, that was the other thing, about signing the net technologies, you did. sign it at the meeting, so I...
You're jumping ahead again. Just stay on number one. Where is the document that says what we did? Is it stapled to this, or is it...
So I really don't know what happened with your packet, so I'm gonna have to just come up and look.
Yeah, it's fine.
We had two memos. One was dated March 12th, and one was dated March 13th. You should have had one of each.
Yeah, but I'm looking at this one right now.
But, no, you have two March 12ths.
And this is the one you said was not good. This was in the packet.
What I'm saying is that you got two of the same memo.
So what? I got this. This is the one we said we're talking about.
But what I need is with the other one. So maybe you got two of the same. So, oh, great, okay, you got two of them. So what I'm trying to find is...
Okay.
Oh, yeah, that's what I was trying to find.
Okay, and where's the minutes?
So here is the minutes from June 28th.
Mm-hmm.
That's where you talked about this project. And...
There's a shortfall needed, so it's going to cover $90,000.
Okay, we'll get there. I'm going to stay on the water right now.
Okay. Oh, there's mine. There's mine.
Okay. So,
Jim, where are the minutes? You asked if it needed to go through town meeting, and you were told no.
Okay.
You need the contract signed in order to
cover the necessary funds. 20% of the budget remaining, so there's money to do this. Contract to be signed to encumber the funds. Try to send the budget remaining. Okay, so we're saying you said that there was 90,000. You wanted to encumber. We had 20% of the 8% of the budget left, which was supposed to have covered that. And so, how does this answer that first question? How do we encumber the excess for the budget line? I'll see the same numbers.
I'm working on number one to get, I didn't have it in time for tonight's meeting, but I'm working with the town accountant to get the further information on the encumbrances.
Okay, I don't see the answer in this, I guess is what I'm saying.
No, it wasn't. This was, I was...
So you attached the minutes, but we discussed it?
This was to show that you signed, this is when you signed the contract, because that comes down the road where they're saying that you didn't sign this at a public meeting.
Okay.
So just
okay. So that answers number. You need to get
more information
on number one.
Yes.
So let's put that on the agenda for next week as well.
Right.
Okay. So that brings into number two. Tanya's to the contract number two. What happens? Security upgrade authorization to award the town offers the technologies the amount of. It's eligible for loan SRF over the contract. It's dated June 15th. When do we vote on it? Is this the same set of minutes?
Yes.
The June 28th?
Yes. So in your packet with the March 12th memo is, it looks like this.
Yeah. The award document?
Yep. Right. Mm-hmm. This is the authorization from Kelly Taylor to move forward with the project. And there's some emails that are attached. Mm-hmm. At this point, SRF was just, they wanted us to just move this project along. So they gave us authorization to, that's what this first, authorization to award checklist. So they gave us authorization to move forward with getting the things needed on the checklist. The issue is the letter from SRF is dated July 26th, I believe is what I think.
And do we have
so they're letter? Questioning why did the Board of Water Commissioners sign the contract when you didn't have the official letter from SRF stating that you had the money? I believe that's just the gist of the question.
Mm-hmm.
So the reason is because we did get authorization. It wasn't in the form of that letter. We got authorization prior to, because they wanted us to move it along.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what this is, that we'll attach with our response to for number two.
And that was 6/21, and then this is July 7/20.
July 20th.
Okay, so we did this on June, and this in July.
So, but if you look in the contract, because there were several people that had to sign this 7/16, 7/15, somebody signed, there's all different dates that people signed here. June 13th, somebody signed. So this document, because we had to have originals, all the originals had to go from body to body to body. So whenever anybody signed it, they quit their date. But the problem is, I believe, is on the front page of the agreement, it says July 20th, and the board signed on June 28th. That's what the issue is.
But we authorized, we voted and authorized this.
Right, so the selectmen were probably not aware of this.
Okay.
So this is part of that response that says, yeah, okay, we did sign it at a meeting, yeah, and here's why we did it early.
It was in our own best interest. Okay.
So that's, I believe that was all in the question two. Yeah, that pretty much answers question number two.
All right, let me get back to my documents.
So, Mary Beth, just so I can put, so the answer to question two, part B, why did the Board of Water Commissioners sign the Net Technologies contract prior to receiving approval from the DEP, is that we understood that we received approval from the DEP.
Yes.
And that approval was in the form of an email that essentially said, get the checklist done.
Yes, exactly.
And this came from Kelly Taylor, and she would then execute it upon receipt. She would have authorized it upon receipt of this completed checklist.
Right, because one of the things that was holding up the whole process, because we've been waiting since for a couple of weeks prior to that, the contractor was having a hard time, something getting the proper documentation for part of these SRF problems, to have the WBE and the minorities groups being able to bid on these jobs. It's one of the requirements. So he was having a hard time getting the paperwork, and Kelly didn't want us to hold up the whole process just because of one piece of paper. And that's why we were authorized to move forward.
So does Ms. Taylor have a copy of the authorization to award checklist with the unchecked boxes checked?
I don't know. This came from them.
Well, I think we should. So we've got the request for authorization for the award, and then we've got
on 6/21. On 6/21, we got approval for the money. It's right there.
Which item?
On the authorization to award checklist.
There's an email in the background.
There's an email attached. But on page one, it says total eligible amount, $111,553, and this on 6/21.
Right.
And the board signed the contract with approval on 6/28, is what I'm saying. That's what this is what this document is showing, is that you had approval from SRF to sign that contract when it came our way, when it was our turn to sign.
From the DEP.
SRF DEP, same.
Well, you need to be clear, because not everyone gets that.
Sorry.
It's all right. Because that was one of the questions I heard. Oh, you don't have authorization.
What was that? What was the question?
That's what I've heard come back, that you don't have authorization. Well, we do, from the DEP, saying, you know, here's the checklist, you know, do this, and then move, you know, you want to do it, move forward if you want to get the SRF portion of that.
If you read the bottom of the next to the last page, that's the email from DEP. I don't know if you read that or not.
That's all I'm reading just now.
Mm-hmm. What we've got is Weston and Sampson's interpretation of the email from Kelly Taylor. which is a provisional, I read it as a provisional acceptance. We need to have the highlighted documents in hand prior to issuing the authorization to award.
If they want to execute the contract, start the ineligible work, and bill Raleigh directly before we have paperwork in place, that is fine.
Well, that's not clear to me what that means.
Well, I mean,
but I know how we understood it. I know how Weston and Sampson understood it, and therefore what they probably communicated to us.
And that was June last year.
What's ineligible work?
That was June 27th. We signed on June 28th, correct?
Yes, June
28th. The next day.
Mm-hmm.
So I mean that's what happened. If that's wrong, then you know
we'll do it different next time.
Well, we'll be a little more cautious, and I even said that to people in the last public meeting that you know I've done this for 2 years. You just started. You've got a year under your belt and experience, and you've been coming up to speed phenomenally rapidly, Bernie. On the financial stuff, so
obviously not fast enough.
No. Well, you know what? It's we're not. I wouldn't call us a seasoned board, but moving forward and trying to keep it up on the up and up. So, if it's wrong, then we'll be instructed otherwise, and that's what happened. I mean, you've got the track record there, the audit trail. Show them the audit trail, and then if there's yeah, literally. So, are you good with that, Mary Beth? Do you understand what we're saying?
Yes, I do.
You don't.
Where are signatures from? Signatures?
On this one, I think we just voted on this one. The authorization to award. I didn't think you were here.
Yeah, because there's only two of us signed.
Yeah.
I was just noticing that. I didn't see Bernie's signature on that.
No.
Not guilty, Your Honor.
Well, we'll look at the minutes of the meeting and find out.
Yeah.
So, but again, guys, you signed it, but there's not a date on it. And the date for the document is not related to...
And we don't have the full minutes. We only have the page.
But that's the only section you talked about it.
No, we're just looking to see if Bernie was there.
Oh, I can tell you that.
When did you get elected, Bernie? Has it been a whole year?
Yeah.
Was it last May?
It was May.
Yeah. Then you would have been here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I didn't notice his signature on it.
You're walking the plank with us.
There's no proof, Your Honor.
Commissioner Bernard Cullen.
Okay, yeah, because I don't think we've had any meetings without Bernie.
No. We've done well over the last year about making sure we've had full staff.
Well,
I mean, I missed one meeting. It was a special that you guys held for something.
The more relevant issue here is that this contract is not dated.
It is, right in the back. Oh, you're talking about the front page of it?
The signature's not dated.
Mine is not, no.
Marks.
But this is June 15th. You talking about this one? Oh.
That's something else.
Sorry, that's a different contract.
So no wonder they're confused, because we're confused.
It's also almost 9 o'clock. Well, for number two, it says why before from the DEP, and I'm satisfied with the email and acting on those instructions, and I think that's the response back.
That's basically, the way I read it, it gives us permission to sign and execute the contract.
Yeah, so that's what we did. That's the answer.
Any other questions? Number three. Department security upgrade projects being paid out of the SRF, according to July 26th DEP letter, was $111,000. Was eligible for the SRF. Eligibility determination report shows the line upgrades had a base bid of 99 plus an alternative A of 51. You have no appropriation to supplement the SRF funding. Until the board during the meeting.
So in your packet, you can, as a paper, it looks like this, it's the bid tab. So you can just get a quick overview of what, you know, alternate A, B, and C. Yep.
That's it?
It is.
So this will give you an idea what they're talking about in that one. These are the two results from the two people that bid on the job. So we're looking at the Net Technologies column. So the total project was $167,458.
Yep.
And SRF gave us the $111,553. So at the same meeting, that's when we talked about this, where I told you where the encumbered funds were going to come from. $17,000 from engineering and $73,000 from the maintenance line and the water treatment plant for a total of $90,000 we were going to encumber. What's this one? That's right out of the envelope from the packet we talked about.
It's, where am I looking here?
I think you, this would have been attached with the, we had two memos, you had three like packs, and you had two memos. One was the 13th and one was the 12th, and I put them.
This is the 12th one.
It's
the,
oh, it's right here, this one. That's
okay.
What you.
Oops, that thing.
This is what we're, it might be over here. Is this yours?
No, this is the stuff prior to that.
Oh, okay. You can have mine.
And so their question
I'm
is.
I'm sure I got it in here.
Yeah, I assume
it's.
Oh, you
she's
can't
she's
find yours either?
I will find it. It's,
okay.
I know that I saw
it. Is this a part two of the previous item? Security upgrades. Security upgrades. So question three is still part of the same item issue, correct?
It's just it is. It's just another question on it. Yes.
So it says you have no appropriation to supplement this. This is a part of that. The funding that it did not come out of the operating funds. So where did we take this money out of? I guess operating.
It's out in the margin. That's
yeah.
Where the money came from. $17,000 from the engineering line.
Yeah.
And $73,000 from the water treatment plant maintenance line for a total of $90,000.
So in essence.
So the way I'm reading this is they're saying that this is a project that should have been an article to pay for this, and we're paying for it out of our maintenance fees.
Yeah, operating funds.
Yeah, which goes back to previous administrations and what you said was behind you.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So that was a mistake. We shouldn't have done it that way. But one of the questions, Mary Beth, on your document here, you've got the maintenance line and the engineering ops labor, 177 and 17. Why are those?
I don't know what those notes.
They're not relevant?
I think they're not relevant. I don't know what those are. It's my large handwriting in the outside.
Okay. So, in fact, they are correct. We paid capital stuff out of operating.
Yes.
And
it
won't
happen again.
I mean, is this a censure item? I mean, we get, you know, we'll be more cautious.
Well, I think there are two issues. One is that we did it. The second is that when they asked us about it, we didn't
have the facts.
We didn't have the facts.
Mm-hmm.
Well, this is the first time we've met as a board
mm-hmm.
since this all came out. So.
No,
yeah, so we're playing catch up.
So this is our chance to answer it.
Yep.
So it's not that we didn't answer it. We haven't been able to meet since.
Yep.
No, I think the issue occurred, the issue that they're raising occurred when the, when we agreed to the, funds to be encumbered, and we spent money on a capital project that was not, we encumbered funds for a capital project and then said that our, the operating expenses, and then said we hadn't done it.
Our response is that we thought we could cover the shortfall from OPEX instead of correctly taking it out of CAPEX. Operating expense versus capital expense. Mm-hmm. That's
the proper way to
the
do
bottom
it.
Line.
We should have went to town meeting with an article to cover it.
Right. We didn't. And being the first kind of run through that I've had, seen that, I will be far more cautious in the future.
And none of us realized we were doing it.
Well, I'll let that stand. Yep. Mm-hmm. So, Mary Beth, do you have those answers? And then the other question is, why did you not disclose to the Board of Selectmen? They asked the questions. This is the first time we've met, and we just acknowledge that situation.
Well, Mary Beth made a mistake.
And I, the next meeting, I did make a mistake, and I said I apologize. I didn't realize. I guess the way I was looking at it is that this was part of the, this is the treatment plant's SRF loan.
Mm-hmm.
So if you were to go and look at the SRF paperwork, you're not going to find this because it's in the treatment plant project. It's the whole big $10 million. So all that stuff got plugged into the category. So it's.
But as I said, we covered a CapEx shortfall with OpEx.
Yeah.
You can't do that. And I know that. And
mm-hmm.
did
we
not
all know that. We just
didn't understand it. So, all right. Next item, 4. You're encumbering $74,000 from outside services lines for security attachment 3. How can you encumber $74,000 if you only had $30,000? And why are you approaching capital cushion? Right. So, I don't understand that question. Is this on the same encumbrance sheet?
This is the same project, right?
So. Is that on the same encumbrance sheet that we looked at prior, previously? Do we know?
Oh, this again, this is something that I'm be working with Sue B, trying to... I don't know where it came from that we encumbered $74,000 from the FY16 outside services. I'm not sure.
So you're investigating that?
Yes.
Okay. Can you have a report on that for Tuesday?
I will do my best to have it for Tuesday.
Okay. Does Sue work a half day on the Fridays?
She doesn't work on Fridays or Thursdays. Or you. No, maybe she does. I don't think she works on Fridays.
I know Town Hall only does a half day.
I think no Fridays. And she comes in later in the day and works.
She's there lots of Friday nights.
Well, reach out to her, see what she can
get. I have been since. I was right on her when she came back from her vacation. I was like right in her office.
Okay. All right, so that takes care of.
But there's one other question on there. It says, why are you purchasing capital equipment without seeking town meeting appropriation?
I think we just...
Is that what that's
we
about?
We just addressed that.
Yeah, okay. That's the same as the one above it.
Okay.
That is the one above it, actually.
Okay.
Just so that I'm clear, in case I have to respond to a question. We assumed all this was under the umbrella of the SRF funds. And therefore, if it was under the umbrella of the SRF funds, we would not have had to treat it as a separate capital project.
As a CapEx.
Mm-hmm.
That was a mistake.
Oh, yeah.
And I will say, again, having been an accountant in another life, I am very impressed with the abilities of the selectmen and the FinCom to read this and see these things glaring at them. That's well done.
Occasionally.
No, it's, you know, this is not, well, this is not vanilla.
The issue, I would say, is that once you think that there's something wrong, then it's much easier to find why it's wrong. And we have a very visible security system that people think shouldn't be here. And that's what's led to the microscope. And the microscope is valid, and it uncovered things that, I mean, if it was all within the SRF funds, people would still be upset.
Mm. But the security system and the additional projects, the carved sign and everything, that was well spoken about for 2 years. 2015, it was talked about. So it's not like people didn't know that we were discussing these projects to use for the rest of the,
It's one thing that, to talk about, make sure we do the right thing. When people see it is when they start paying attention.
I know. But I'm just saying, it's not like we try to sweep it under the carpet.
No,
it was well talked about it at several meetings.
Mm-hmm.
That's all.
And everyone has an opinion. I'll leave it at that. No, really. I mean, everyone's got an opinion on what it should be. But
it's true.
I'd welcome anyone to run and step in here. So the next memo is in order from March 13th.
Yes.
Follow-up questions, and these are from Debbie. So, water security upgrade projects. There is no progression. Why did you sign a contract? We've already addressed that.
Yeah, I think that's a little. I think it's redundant.
It's redundant, but I mean, you've got this. It's the same answer.
Separate answer is. We signed a contract for $167,000 in the base bid with alternates total of $150,000. So there are some specifics.
I thought we took the best bid.
It's the add-ons. The add-ons, because it's alternate pay, alternate
fee. No, that's what we just told a minute ago.
That's what I'm looking for.
You can see it on this page, this one, it has the bottom right here.
That's the one I'm looking for.
That's what we had. That's why it was 167, because it adds that way.
So just provide that to her.
Yep.
That is the answer.
Yes.
And say we took the lowest bid after the add-ons.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Water distribution study and capital efficiency. Copy the tenant contract to prepare the distribution study and capital efficiency.
The contract amount must match the bid price. So there's another issue which is in the contract.
No, it's 167.
So it's not.
The contract was for 167. Where's that corporate date? $167,458 is what the contract was done for.
So you need to identify the page and line of the contract.
So you can see it's right there. Bolded and underlined in the contract. Page one. In the agreement.
So give her a copy of the contract.
Sure.
And then the bid sheet that shows the differences.
Yeah. Yep. Okay. Check that. And I have, which you also have in your packet, because it was asked for, was for the water distribution study. I have to turn in for the response. I have a copy of the contract for that one.
So the question is, why?
Why was it an article saying that capital expense?
Was it a capital expense just because we're having a study done?
Well, that's
what I want to know. a definition of what a capital expense is, and because I'm not sure.
Yeah.
You know, Water Management Act permitting, that's not a capital project. That's me needing engineering assistance. It's operations.
But
unless the definition, the way capital is done in Rowley, then maybe that is a capital.
So let's just say, what is the definition for the town of a capital project? And then if not, then, you know, that's correct. We should have gone. But our understanding is that we could have funded it out of what we did. Studying plans, are those capital or not? I'll be honest, I don't know. Okay.
You would never be able to get anything done if you had to put everything.
Well, just ask for clarification. That's all I want to know.
Okay.
So.
I will.
Water Management
Act. There's a presupposition that if you don't go to contract, you're likely to be involved in a capital project. That's what they're.
And the Water Management Permit Assistance, I think we did that the year before as well. Didn't we?
No, that's what she's talking about.
But I mean, even the year before that,
yeah.
Wasn't that the way we did it?
Yeah. So I have a copy of the contract for that.
Based on historical precedence. If it should be different, then I'd be glad to do it differently if it should be different.
Mm-hmm.
So let's just say, historically, that's what we've done. If it should be a town meeting article, we'll be having a lot of town meeting articles if that's the case.
That's something they want. That's fine with me.
Yeah.
Well,
I just
need a definition.
I don't know that I want to. I mean, permit assistance is like saying if we have to get legal counsel, we have to ask to put it on a warrant. That makes no sense at all. So this strikes me as being part of the ordinary nature of the business.
We had budgeted for this, I believe. Because
we
had that discussion during the budget the year before, so that when it came up, we'd have money in the budget to pay for it. So
the underlying issue, I think, is how come we need assistance to do the Water Management Act permit assistance? Why do we need the assistance? Well, how come we can't do that within the water department? I mean, I think that's the question behind the question here.
Yeah.
That's for you, Mary Beth. I mean, is that something that we just don't have the people to do, or is the knowledge in-house, or is that?
It's the knowledge in-house. It's the extent of the permitting process. This is your withdrawal permit. There's stuff to do with the wells. It's the withdrawal permit. It's what our Management Act permit to operate. It's our operations permit. So it's a lot more involved than just filling in a piece of paper. If it was just as simple as filling out a form, I'd do it myself.
Maybe we need that written out so we all know what it is.
What would you like, Mark? What would you like me to do?
What that entails, so that they can understand.
Oh, sure.
Yeah, elaborate on what
it is all about. It's not just a fill out a 3-page form.
Well, do we have a completed Water Management Act permit application?
Well, we have a permit.
Right, but what do we have the output of Taylor and Howard?
No.
Well, then we better get the output of Taylor and Howard.
Why don't we have it? They don't provide it?
No, we're working on it.
Well, but on the previous year.
They're saying
we've agreed to spend $15,000.
Yes.
Because the job is complex and requires a lot of work.
Right.
So we need a concrete example of what that final output is, so to demonstrate the fact that it isn't reasonable to expect us to do it in-house. It makes sense for us to use a third party.
Basically justify it.
Justify it. It doesn't have to be the current one. It just has to be, I mean, if it's 3 pages, we're in trouble. If it's 50 pages, we're home free, right?
Right.
Of complex analysis. I mean,
sure.
Yeah, this is not a license permit. I mean, it looks, just the title suggests that it's a pretty pro forma kind of thing. When I take your word for it, that it's a much more complex thing to do.
Next one. Unidirectional flushing plan. They send her a copy of the Tater and Howard contract for $19,000 to provide the water department with the unidirectional flushing plan. We encumbered $19,000 for the plan while I was in the study funded through the town meeting warrant article. That's the same thing. If everything we do needs, I mean, we'll be having 20 articles.
We still need that definition. Is what do we need to? Mm-hmm. Because
it's really.
I consider that part of doing business, but
yeah.
Other people don't.
But it's raising questions, so.
Right, but again, it's what is it about this flushing plan that requires us to go outside?
Maps. We don't.
Well,
here it is, right here.
I was gonna say I don't have my copy of it right here.
This is the plan. This is the entire distribution system placed on in a grid system, with maps to allow us to flush the system. This is the plan right here. It's
quiet work.
There's no way we could have done this.
Was like
in house.
I've gone through every page of it so far.
So that's what I'm saying.
I'm not questioning it.
Yeah.
No, you asked what it is. I brought it out for show and tell.
Mm-hmm.
Right. So then even hasn't seen it.
And normally they wouldn't see it.
It's,
this is
it's
a water
not,
department.
It's not even a finished document
it's
yet.
Not, this is draft. This isn't even
I just finished going through it.
Yeah.
I know.
We just
got
this.
We got beat up for not having a plan for the paving, and I said we just got that document officially.
Mm-hmm.
I can't plan for something I just got.
So we've got two separate issues here.
Okay.
One is that we're using Taylor and Howard to do a lot of engineering service work.
Mm-hmm.
There's an assumption that the selectman that spoke to, which, and Deb spoke to, which raised issues about how come we're not doing it in-house. We do it in-house, it's, even if it's exactly the same output, it's not regarded as a capital project.
Okay, well, I'm not an engineer. So
it's
I can't do a lot of these things.
Mary,
I'm not being
it's
defensive, Bernie. I'm just saying I'm not an engineer. I know it was mentioned about doing things in-house. This is beyond, some of these things are way beyond me. I'm not an
so
engineer.
So that's our response. This is beyond the technical capabilities of the department.
The proof is
the stance.
You show them the plan. And it's pretty straightforward. It's pretty simple. So then it, we get to this point about, you know, at what point when we have to do something which if we were a larger system and had in-house engineering capability, we would do in-house.
No, you wouldn't. And I've been doing this for 20 years. I've been a water superintendent in Mason Place for three or four communities. The superintendent always has engineering money for technical support for things like this in the operating budget. That's just, I mean, Raleigh might do it differently, but that's my experience. So if I needed to say, geez, you know, DEP is going to be coming around seeing if we have a unidirectional flushing plan, I better contact the engineering company. And a water department is usually an enterprise fund, so you can't, in a bigger system, you cannot use, for the most part, the services of engineering. They don't do the water stuff. They usually work with the paving and other aspects of a DPW or a town. You always have a separate engineering firm that, before Taylor and Howard, you had Haley and Ward for what, how many years?
We are going to take a 2-minute timeout.
Okay.
So.
Works for me.
Sorry.
Thank
you. So we're back on, Bernie.
Okay.
So the water department started doing this back in 2013. Taking the, you know, free cash and rolling it over to stabilization that was voted at town meeting. So that's the monies that you've collected. That's it.
Yeah.
And so what I've done is the monies that are being spent, these are projects we currently have going right now.
Yeah.
So you can see where the money is going to. And then I put, added in what's proposed.
Yeah.
These are the articles. After the board approved them, I thought it would be a good idea to say, hey, there's some more stuff we're doing, and I put it up there. And then there's your stabilization balances.
Yeah.
That's what we have, I don't know where.
That's the bottom line.
I don't know where the, where $1 million come from.
Well, they're just saying our revenue is gonna be so much that between that and stabilization, we'll have $1 million in free cash, and I'm like, it doesn't make sense.
Well, the free cash is really irrelevant. The issue is, what's the stabilization balances?
It's right there, as of December 6th, 2016.
No, I understand, but from a financial point of view, it's the stabilization balances, which is essentially uncommitted money that's, we have somehow, we
it's
have
our capital to do projects with.
Yeah. So that's what it, otherwise you have to subtract from the free cash the money that's already been committed for various projects in order to end up with the stabilization balances, because there's flows backwards and forwards.
Right, so what will happen is, when we go to town meeting and the article will be on to vote this certified free cash, it will roll into stabilization.
Yeah.
I will be putting in a new balance here.
Right. However, doesn't all the capital projects come out against that?
Right, so last year we had about 700,000 in capital improvements, or this current fiscal year.
Yeah.
So, the big one, of course, was the dehumidification.
Yeah.
Right, so what they're looking at is the free cash that just got certified, you're going to add that to the stabilization balance?
Correct.
And that free cash number was what, again?
187,278.
So that brings us to about 600,000.
Minus what you have for capital, what you have will be planned for capital for
right.
FY18.
Right.
And then what's capital for, what's roughly the capital?
300.
Minus 300. Leaves us about 312, which is
yeah, but I'm, what,
not unreasonable.
No. That's,
no,
your that's
not
what's left over.
No. That,
no,
I mean, that's
for a
approved
$3 million a year budget. It's, that's I would be nervous if there was less money in the bank than that.
Yeah, no, from a prudent man standpoint, which is a financial term, that's a prudent approach. And, you know, to have, if we had 600,000 consistently, that's too much. If we only had 100 or 50,000, that's sorely underfunded. So I think we're right in the right place, given the things that have had to go on. I'm not saying that's not going to change over time, but we're addressing a lot of things that had to be get done. The whole big thing on the horizon here is the whole water mains. What's that going to mean? But we need time to figure that out. We'll be coming with a plan on that probably within the next year, I think.
Exactly. So what I was going to be doing, because that was the other issue that came up about, you know, we need to plan. Well, planning takes time, and I want to do it right.
Mm-hmm.
So the first thing we did was the water mains. That was huge. Okay, that's
mm-hmm.
That affects water quality, all kinds of things. So we needed to get that. We now have a 20-year capital improvement plan laid out for water main replacement. But that's not all we have to do. The other thing we're doing is the above-ground assets. We're in the process of doing the inventory and the studies and getting all of the stuff together. So my goal is to, hopefully, by the next budget period, have a 10 to 20-year capital plan that encompasses the mains, the source of supply, the plans. The plans will start to roll, and then that's going to become an excellent tool for the water board to say, okay, here's what's coming up for FY19 capital. Have discussions about it. Do you want to move forward with these projects? And have the ability to move things as things become more important.
Yeah. It's getting late. I know we're keeping the camera person here late too, but so the next two things, the unidirectional flushing, we said, you know, give her a copy of that plan.
Yep.
And then the encumbrances, it goes back to our other statement that we thought we could cover the CapEx with OpEx. We did not, you know, we took funds from other places and encumbered them, and that was a mistake. And we are aware of it and will be much more cautious. Or seek counsel if we do need to move funds, or forego things if we need to wait for a town meeting.
So just two things. What I was planning on doing was taking all of this and drafting up a cover letter, response letter,
mm-hmm.
which I was going to email to the board
mm-hmm.
for your input.
Please do.
And I will
take care of putting all of the, gathering all of the attachments that we're going to have to support. And then maybe if we could put that on the agenda for next week to publicly discuss the memo. Mm-hmm. We do have a deadline of April 3rd to respond to the selectmen, so just a reminder.
Yeah, so the only personal view I would say is I think most of the questions that have come up have been completely valid. They've raised real substantive issues and real financial issues, and we appreciate the attention, and our response is in the light of accepting the fundamental points that have been raised.
I agree completely.
So
yes, well said.
We want, if there is a backwards and forwards in terms of responses, we want to maintain it as constructive and positive in helping us to essentially nail down best practice and transparency. So a lot of this, I think, is because it's confusing and unclear.
Yeah. I had several people comment to me, they're like, please don't be upset, this is not personal, and I took none of this personally, and completely constructive, and it was the other boards doing their jobs. And I have to say, I learned, I'm not pleased, however, I learned a lot more about municipal finance, the nuances and the things you can and can't do, and again, the OPEX CAPEX question, and I look forward to the response about how do we determine that, and if we need to do more at town meeting, so we shall. Okay, now you got to say something.
Make a motion, we adjourn.
I will second.
One moment.
You did not discuss one of your, unless you want to table it, you have another agenda item. Agenda item number four.
Four?
Discuss and vote to send a request to the Board of Selectmen to approve a change order for adding the installation of the above ground sampling tap to the Prospectil tank.
Yeah, it was like 10,000.
Yes, yeah, so.
Versus going out to bid.
What I was going to say is that I do not have a quote for, it was too short. You asked me to add this to the agenda.
Yeah, just so we could discuss it.
So what, after talking with Ryan from Tater and Howard, it would be better if we just got three prices, because timing, by the time this goes to the selectmen, you know, with the meeting thing, it will just come along. So we're just going to just get three prices, because it's, if that's okay with the board for that particular part. That's covered under the 225 for the sanitary survey project. Mm-hmm. We just thought it might, they were already up there, you know.
It's a logical approach, but sometimes we can't use logic in the public sector.
Sometimes it's all timing.
Yeah, I agreed. Bernie, so okay with that?
Well, yes, with the one comment that, you know, I'm not, we've existed for a long time without an above ground sampling tank.
This isn't a choice. This is sanitary survey compliance. The DEP said you have to have it. We can no longer use the below grade sample tap that we have.
And that's a new.
No, it's not a new thing. It's
a standard we never adhered to.
How did we get away with it previously?
The regulation must have changed between 3 years ago and now to have
it's,
that.
It's considered a confined space.
Confined space.
So that means that you have to go through making out your permit, set up your tripod or whatever you need
to do.
It has to be two men, one up, one down, air monitoring, the whole spiel.
Plus, because the sample tap is below grade, and if that vault ever floods, or if there's a compromising in any way, and if we get a sample and it comes back positive for E. coli, the DEP will not allow us to use the sample tap as an excuse.
I remember that from when we discussed it.
Okay.
My question was, how come we got away with it? Getting away with it is the right choice of words. How come this is happening now as opposed to 5 years ago or 3 years ago?
The regulations must have changed.
Well,
between
Or the enforcement person.
Sometimes it's.
I know some of those things on the list.
We don't know.
Have been on for quite a while.
All I know is that they said you have to do it.
Well, the thing is, can't we just weld a big piece of pipe, like a big U-shape?
No, it has to have specific criteria.
Yeah, with a yard hydrant.
Yeah, a big U-shape, bring it up above grade.
It's got to have specific requirements.
I know.
Then we should do whatever.
It's basically a safety thing, number one, for our employees.
Yeah, that's...
As being somebody that's been in that pit numerous occasions years ago.
So anyways, let's do it the right way, do the three bids, et cetera, et cetera.
So just want to vote no?
Is there anything, again, judging from the spirit of the discussion with the selectmen, is there a reason why we need Tater and Howard to prepare a bid?
We're not preparing a bid spec. I'm just going
to
get three
it's
prices.
It's not going out to bid.
It's not going
per
out
se.
To bid.
It's on formal bids. It's going to be requested because it's under the threshold for the bid laws that you can go out and get, this is what we need to do.
Right.
Okay. How much you're going to cost? How much is it going to cost? Informal.
You're not having them do the bid spec, are you?
No, Tater and Howard is doing the contract for the stormwater improvement.
They just
so
gave
in
advice.
Order to... So they would have to do a change order, and the change order would have to get approved by the Board of Selectmen to have T4 do this additional work. We'd pay for it. That's why
Tater and Howard. It's just all intertwined with the road.
So yeah, we can just go out and
if we do it just separate, sorry.
We're going to get three prices.
Will we need a special town meeting article for it?
No, it's already been done. We already had an article for that, right?
Four.
For the work that you're talking about, this is all the...
$75,000. You had an article, we've already spent it, $75,000 for our contribution to the stormwater road improvement.
No, we're talking about the
above grade
sanitary survey stuff is an article.
Yes, that's the $225,000 for sanitary survey.
So we'll have $10,000
on that. Right here, right here. That's your last... We did this at fall town meeting in October.
But we'll have $10,000 to go against that?
It's included in the $225,000.
Yeah.
All of the sanitary survey compliance was one article, 225.
Okay.
Alright.
So could you just vote no from just for sake of completion then?
Yes, I make a motion to vote no on a change order.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you.
Make a motion, adjourn.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Good.